Good morning. Can I welcome everyone to the seventh meeting of the Education and Skills Committee in 2017? And can I please remind everyone present to turn their mobile phones and other devices onto silent for the duration of the meeting? The first item of business is an evidence session with John Swinney, the Cabinet Secretary for Education and Skills, on school education. I welcome the Cabinet Secretary to the meeting and his officials, Fiona Robertson, Director of Learning, and Donna Bell, Deputy Director, Strategy and Performance. Good morning. Since mid-January, we have looked at a number of issues around school education. We have held an evidence session on the CFE Management Board. We've undertaken a number of focus groups, largely comprising of teachers. We've undertaken a survey of publicly funded mainstream secondary schools on the senior phase. We've surveyed higher education institutions about their entry requirements for young people taking SQA qualifications. We've held roundtables on additional support needs and personnel and social education, and we continue to receive submissions from individuals and organisations on Scottish school education. Can I once again thank all the teachers, parents and young people that have taken the time to inform this work. Today's session will involve questions to the Cabinet Secretary on three topics in the following order: additional support needs, personal and social education, and the delivery of curriculum for excellence. And I understand the Cabinet Secretary wishes to make a brief opening statement.
Thank you, Convener, and I look forward to discussing these three issues with the committee. And if I can perhaps set some of the context for that. On curriculum for excellence, the government recognises and accepts that all education systems will face challenges, and Scotland's education system is no different. But I believe we are starting from a position of strength, and the overwhelming majority of children and young people are performing well under curriculum for excellence. Notwithstanding my confidence in the foundations provided by Curriculum for Excellence, a culture of continuous improvement embedded by the National Improvement Framework must remain a key characteristic of Scottish education. This is the means by which we will ensure that all of our young people have the opportunity to excel in a way that works for them as individuals. I'm clear that we must put the child at the centre of our policies through the approach of getting it right for every child and Curriculum for Excellence, and focus on meeting the needs of every child as an individual, which is therefore an important connection to the other two topics that the committee raises about additional support for learning and personal and social education. On additional support for learning, Scotland has one of the most inclusive systems for the provision of support in schools. We have a system which focuses on barriers to learning, and it is that approach that makes Scotland stand out from others. This approach is well regarded across Europe and has been adopted by a number of other countries. A cornerstone of our inclusive approach is the presumption of mainstreaming for those with additional support needs. We know that significant numbers of children and young people and their families have benefited from this inclusive approach. There is, however, a necessity for us to ensure that the approach to mainstreaming is undertaken in an effective fashion, which is why I have commissioned a review of the guidance on mainstreaming to ensure that the existing guidance reflects the legislative and policy context and also succeeds in delivering on the expectations of individuals. I can confirm with the committee today that the extended consultation on this guidance will begin on the 19th of May and it will run until the end of August, enabling individuals over a long period of time to respond to the issues. The system in Scotland has much to be admired and much to be proud of, but we also have to accept that no system will be perfect, and I'm clear that we're committed to ensuring that children receive the support that they need, and we will continue to work hard to make this even better. Lastly, Convener, on personal social education, this is essentially demonstrated through Curriculum for Excellence by the emphasis on health and well-being, which is spread right through the curriculum. It is represented not by a single subject or class, but it's organised into six areas which provide a holistic view around mental, emotional, social and physical well-being, planning for choices and changes, physical education, physical activity and sport, food and health, substance misuse and relationships, sexual health and parenthood. PSE is a taught subject which covers aspects of planning for choices and changes and the other aspects that I set out in my comments. I'm interested in the evidence that the committee has gathered of reflections around this issue, and of course the government has also invited the Equal Opportunities Committee to reflect on a number of questions in relation to the guidance that is associated with aspects of PSE in relation to relationships, sexual health and parenthood, and we look forward to hearing feedback from that committee on those questions. And I look forward also to engaging with this committee on the issues that arise on the challenges in personal and social education. The government is obviously undertaking a range of different reforms on education, and I'm very happy to discuss those with the committee this morning.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. We will start. We have a number of important issues on the agenda, and I've asked the committee members and asked the witnesses to keep questions and answers as succinct as possible. In addition, members are reminded to ensure supplementary requests relate directly to the issue under discussion. And as I mentioned earlier, we're starting with additional support needs. Can I ask, in regards to young people with additional support needs, what work is being done to ensure that best practice in local authorities is being carried out across all local authorities? Because there does seem to be a disparity between some local authorities and others. And is the focus changing from inputs to outcomes? And if so, can we be assured that this is the right way to go about it?
On the question of assurance of performance, there are obviously a variety of different ways in which performance in individual parts of the country are assessed. Some of that will be undertaken through the inspection work that's undertaken by Education Scotland or by the Care Inspectorate. Some of it will be undertaken in terms of the assessment of the handling of cases, which may eventually end up in a tribunal situation if there is a dispute about the way in which additional support needs are being provided to individuals. But fundamentally, the statutory responsibility rests with local authorities to ensure that provision is being delivered in accordance with the needs of every child, and that requires an assessment to be made of the needs and the circumstances of every young person that's involved. Clearly, there will be a great deal of work undertaken to design and determine the most appropriate approaches to take, and it will be for individual local authorities to form their own conclusions on that point. Lastly, Kavira, your point about the shift from inputs to outcomes, I think, is an interesting example of, I think, what is a reflection of what is trying to be achieved within the support that's available. We are trying to ensure that the needs of young people are best met, to ensure they can fulfil their potential. So yes, the focus will be increasingly on the outcomes that can be achieved, but a crucial determinant of the outcomes that can be achieved is the proper support that can be put in place to meet the needs of those individuals.
Thank you. Can I just go back to the first point about being the responsibility of the local authorities? As you quite rightly say, this is about getting it right for every child. What role does the Scottish Government have then to ensure that if there is a clear disparity in the fact that some local authorities might be getting it more right for every child than others, what role does the Scottish Government have it?
Well, our approach is essentially to create the frameworks within which the additional support needs are met, to create those expectations on local authorities and to ensure that local authorities are working to deliver on those questions. Then obviously the role of the inspectorate is crucial in assessing all of these questions in guaranteeing that the quality of intervention that is put in place at local level meets what all of us would expect within the statutory framework that Parliament has provided for.
Okay, thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Ross Thompson.
Thank you very much, convener. Cabinet Secretary, the committee received quite overwhelming evidence from teachers that they've been limited in their ability to support pupils who do have additional support needs. Now, that was from witnesses as well as the submissions as well to the committee, because they've seen real cuts in teaching assistants. Sylvia Hockney stated that things were better 20 years ago when she was going through the profession, where she said, "We were given training direct from a psychologist, from a speech language therapist, to give us an understanding and knowledge of what we're looking for. That is just gone." How do you respond to that, Cabinet Secretary?
I saw the evidence that the committee heard last week, and obviously there are elements of that evidence that are troubling. The example that I think it was Ms. Hockney cited of the training for autism awareness was, in my view, wholly unacceptable. As a consequence of that, I've made inquiries of Glasgow City Council to establish their view on that, which I think is important that I do that. And Glasgow City Council have provided me with what I can only describe as very comprehensive information on the framework with which they deploy the training of individuals who will be responsible for supporting individuals with additional support needs, and particularly those on the autism spectrum. And I have in front of me the provision and good practice document from Glasgow City Council, which in my estimation is a very comprehensive reference guide of what the local authority would expect of its staff. And I think it's important to put that on the record to ensure that the committee hears very, I'm not a spokesperson for Glasgow City Council, but I did want to satisfy myself that the City Council had a strong framework in place for handling these issues. And I've seen the provision of good practice document. I've seen the good practice document, which is the practical manifestation of this, and then also the specific training that's put in place for autism spectrum disorder by the City Council, all of which appear to me to be very comprehensive frameworks that the City Council have in place. And that is, you know, that's what I think all of us would expect of a local authority, and I'm glad to see that it exists in Glasgow City Council. I was surprised by the evidence you heard last week, because in my estimation, this is not a charge I would level at Glasgow City Council. So I simply put that on the record to say that while it's very important to listen to evidence from individuals, and we have to take evidence seriously, it is also important that we look at the arrangements and the frameworks that are put in place, and that we take steps, as the government does, to support families to ensure that they can receive the support and the assistance that they require to meet the educational needs of their children. And that's the type of arrangement I think we have to have in place to make sure that the needs of young people are met in all circumstances. Now, finally, I made reference in my original answer to the convener about the role of the tribunal, and the law is quite clear on this, that there is a role for the additional support needs tribunal to ensure that families can receive, if they feel thwarted in their dialogue with public authorities, they can seek recourse to a tribunal to resolve the issue. Now, the guidance that we give to local authorities and the approach that I think many local authorities aim to take is to avoid getting to a tribunal by satisfactorily addressing the issues about which parents will be concerned at the earliest possible opportunity. And that would strike me as being the most effective way to act in that fashion.
I thank the Cabinet for his answer. I think you've preempted some more of my questions, so thank you very much, particularly for addressing the point that was raised by Sophia Hockney around about Big Bang Theory. In the submissions, a number of teachers were quite clear that they've seen an impact due to the reduction in the number of teaching assistants in particular, and there's been quite a marked decrease. Do you see a correlation there in terms of the support that is available? And also, what's the steps of the government intending on taking to help improve on that?
The first thing I'd say is that I do acknowledge that there are challenges in public expenditure, and the government works assiduously to try to address those. They are, of course, caused by the fiscal environment in which we operate, Mr. Thompson, which is a product of the political decisions with which you are closely associated. I'm acknowledging that, Mr. Thompson. I'm acknowledging that, but good. I'm also recognising the fact that the fiscal environment of the United Kingdom makes that challenging for us. And obviously, if the government had taken different courses, for example, to pass on a tax cut in the budget, there would have been less money available for public services for the forthcoming financial year. Now, if we look at the number of staff, support staff supporting pupils with additional support needs, in 2008, that was 12,572. In 2016, it was 12,883. When I look at what local authorities are spending on additional support needs, in the latest data that I have available to me, local authority expenditure on additional support needs increased by about £5 million. That total amount of expenditure was £584 million, which was 12% of total educational spend. So the number is increasing. Now, of course, there are many more children identified as having additional support needs, but fundamentally, that is because of the change in the classification of young people with support needs and the broadening of definitions that took place around about 2011-2012.
One more, if that's okay. One more.
We've got a lot to go through.
One more. Thank you very much, convener. First of all, just I'd address the point that the financial environment in independent Scotland would be an awful lot more challenging. But we also received a large number of submissions from, again, parents in particular, suggesting that the access to resources in particular to support their children was different and patchy across the country, where some parents really had to persist, and sometimes it depended on how persistent a particular parent was in relation to the support that they got. What steps, again, can the Scottish Government take to ensure more equal treatment for parents, so they're not having to keep fighting against the machine? And that is something that we seem to come through quite clearly in some of the evidence that we have.
Well, listen, I think a couple of important issues here. There's a question about what the statutory framework here puts local authorities, gives local authorities the responsibility to take forward, as democratically elected organisations, their responsibilities in this respect. And if members of Parliament, members of Parliament quite frequently take exception to me intruding on the roles and responsibilities of local authorities, and Mr Thompson, if I follow the logic of his question, would have me stipulating much more directly to local authorities what they should and should not do in terms of the provision. And I simply offer that as that's a political choice, but statute essentially gives local authorities the ability to design that approach in their locality. Now, what the government does is essentially three things. One is that we provide over a legislative framework which provides recourse for parents who are frustrated by the way in which support is available to their young people, to their children. Secondly, we fund Inquire, which is a national advice and information service which supports parents and equips parents with knowledge and information to navigate their way through the system to ensure that the needs of their young people are met. And thirdly, the government presides over a policy framework which is anchored in the concept of getting it right for every child, which we work with local authority. Every local authority in the country will be signed up to getting it right for every child. And what we have to do is to work with, in partnership with local authorities, to ensure that they have the necessary approaches in place that can ensure that the needs of every single young person are met as part of the education system.
Thank you, convener.
Thank you. I am tempted to say that most parents I speak to would rather that taxpayers' money was spent on issues like this than nuclear weapons, but I won't go down that road in response to Trust Thompson's previous comments about independence. But in terms of the question of resources, additional support needs is very complex in that the situation across Scotland and local authorities is very variable. And of course, every child is different in terms of their needs as well, and that's very difficult to try and take a national picture of as we take forward this debate. But the evidence we have heard time and time again is that it is a question of resources in terms of ensuring that we do get it right for every child, and especially in terms of additional support needs. Do you think, Cabinet Secretary, that in 2004, when the Act was passed, that people, and especially Parliament and the politicians, the government at the time, envisaged the requirements that would exist for resources to make sure we could do this properly?
I think Parliament recognised that in the sense that I don't think Parliament was under the illusion in 2004 that legislation of this type would not require on an individual level a level of expenditure per pupil that would be significantly different to the level of expenditure that would be allocated routinely for primary or secondary education in Scotland. I think Parliament was very clearly aware that this would be a more costly type of provision to put in place. But I think what Parliament was mindful of was of the importance of ensuring that we took steps to address the needs of every single child and that those needs should be effectively met within our education system, whether that was in a mainstream environment or whether that was in some special environment that was available for young people with particular needs. So I think Parliament was cognizant of that point when it passed the legislation and put in place a framework which I think is designed to serve young people extremely well.
Thank you. I mean, like you, Cabinet Secretary, I was in Parliament in 2004 and voted for this legislation. And never for a moment did I think there'd be such a huge demand on resources to fulfil its aims. So I suspect that the public purse has been unprepared for the demands of additional support needs. I'm just trying to work out how we can arm parents with the ability to hold their local authorities to account as to whether or not local authorities are devoting appropriate resources to additional support needs. And I'm wondering whether there's any way in which we could do that on a national basis, or if you've given any thought to how we can actually ascertain what the situation is, because I know the inspectorate goes in there and looks at how schools are fulfilling their obligations, but in terms of the actual resources being allocated, how do we get to the bottom of that?
Fundamentally, I think that this issue has to be addressed through a number of different steps to and opportunities to ensure that the needs of children and young people are being met appropriately within the system. At the very start of the process, where the educational needs of a young person are being identified as being perhaps not going to be mainstream educational requirements, or that a young person has additional needs, it is important that that is addressed properly at the earliest possible opportunity. Yeah. Now, all of our approach, all of our frameworks, all of our guidance to local authorities, all of the requirements of statute place an emphasis on that period. And it's about making sure that early interaction on those questions delivers what families are looking for. And our system is designed to do that. Now, obviously, if that doesn't happen, there is recourse available to families, which ultimately will go through individual decision-making processes in local authorities and may ultimately end up at a tribunal to determine whether the needs of a young person have been met, consistent with the legislation that both Mr. Lockhead and I supported in 2004. But obviously, it is an extremely stressful journey for families who are already dealing with tremendous stress of a young person that will have additional support needs if they have to end up working their way through all of that to get to a tribunal. So in the interests of resolving issues, the emphasis has to be on the earliest possible intervention. Now, there will be, and I would be interested in the committee's view, cognizant of the point that I made to Mr. Thompson about the proper role of local authorities to exercise their functions and to be held to account for them, as to how the committee believes we could apply greater obligations on local authorities to ensure that those needs are met at the earliest possible opportunity. Because by that approach, I think we would have our best opportunity to address the needs of young people within our system.
Okay.
Can I ask one final?
Very briefly.
Just to ask the Cabinet Secretary if also you acknowledge that whilst we're having a big debate over additional support needs and whilst the two subjects are not unrelated, the whole issue of emotional disruptive behaviour is one that teachers constantly raise in terms of not being able to give children enough time in the classroom to do teaching properly.
I think that is a product of the additional support needs debate, and that's again where we have to ensure that we have in place the support and the assistance, and I see many good examples around the country of this being put in place, but equally I deal with constituents who have their frustrations about this issue, and I meet parents, I hear from members of the public around the country of the frustrations that Mr. Lockhead raises with me, and I think it's important that local authorities put in place the arrangements and the support that meet the needs of young people in their educational setting. I think we also have to be open to the fact that the needs of some young people will not be met within a mainstream educational environment, and they need to have more focused support put in place to address those issues, which is, and the judgments about that are implicit in the review of the mainstreaming guidance that I'm taking forward.
Okay, thank you. Gillian, you wanted to come in with a brief
supplementary, leading on from Richard Lockhead's comments about support for parents and actually getting help if they've got challenges in schools. But also I want to look at that from the perspective of teachers. If teachers feel that they're not getting the CPD, is that something that we could look at as well, and also holding local authorities to account if teachers feel that they're not getting the specific CPD to be able to help them in the classroom?
Certainly, there is a need for CPD to be available for members of the teaching profession across this and a range of other issues. And of course, it's important that that's delivered in all circumstances around the country.
Ross Greer.
Thanks, Convener. Cabinet Secretary, of the additional support needs teachers who were imposed in 2010, one in seven are no longer there. One in seven of those posts have been cut. Now, we've debated in the past what the cause for that is, but I'm wondering why in your recently announced recruitment drive for new teachers, none of the proposals specifically address additional support needs teaching.
The proposals that I've announced are about ensuring that we identify new routes to encourage more recruits to come into teaching. I think, you know, in terms of the points that are raised about educational progress, obviously there will be a range of teachers who are meeting the needs of young people in an educational setting that will be broader than just simply those who are identified as teachers with additional support, focused on additional support needs. But what we also have to make sure, this is part of the ongoing dialogue that we have with the initial teacher education system within Scotland, is that in the ITE activity, there is due account taken of equipping new teachers with the skills that they require to support young people with additional support needs.
I agree with you that with one in four young people identified with an additional support need, they cannot all be taught and do not all need to be taught specifically by ASN teachers. But on that point of all teachers being equipped to support young people with additional support needs, one of the proposals in your recent recruitment drive discusses combining the 1 year postgraduate and the 1 year probation. Now, concerns have been raised about that will limit the opportunity for new teachers to receive adequate training in supporting young people with additional support needs. With such clear issues as it stands for mainstream teachers being able to support young people with additional support needs, why are we reducing the amount of time that new people in the profession will get to gain those skills?
That's one of a number of proposals that's been brought forward by colleges of education at my invitation to identify routes by which we would be able to encourage more teachers to come into the classroom and to get them there quicker. But, and there's always a but in this, that cannot compromise the standards that are expected of the General Teaching Council of Scotland. So all of these routes have to be considered and verified and certified by the General Teaching Council, and they may not all get there. So I think it's important that I put that on the record, that these are proposals, and the issues that Mr. Greer raises are legitimate issues for the General Teaching Council to consider to assure themselves that the quality threshold that we expect of all teacher education within Scotland is maintained by each one of these routes. And that's not Whilst I've invited the Colleges of Education to come forward with these proposals, I will not be the decision maker about whether they pass the test. That will be the Independent General Teaching Council for Scotland that will determine that issue.
I accept that, but do you believe that teacher training courses, as they stand, do offer adequate time, adequate opportunity for training and additional support needs?
Yes, but I'm certainly prepared to listen to evidence that suggests to the contrary. And it's something that I will happily discuss with the Colleges of Education to ensure that the breadth of expertise that is required to be generated for the members of the teaching profession are generated as a consequence of initial teacher education.
I believe that the evidence the committee's received would indicate that, so be happy to take that up with you.
I'll look at that.
Thank you very much, Ross. Sorry, Fulton.
James, I'm your next door neighbour in the Parliament. I thought you'd get my name right. thanks, Convener. Actually, my line of questioning has been mainly covered, and I'm glad the Cabinet Secretary has had the opportunity to outline for the record the role of local authorities in this key area. But what I did want to ask about is if we accept that ASN is as part of the overall attainment issue, what's the Cabinet Secretary's view on how the attainment fund may be used to help close the gap with this specific group of young people, and how individual head teachers might have a role in that?
Obviously, we're seeing improvements in the performance of young people with additional support needs. In 86.2% of pupils with additional support needs have a positive destination, which is up on previous years, and we have a rising proportion of pupils with additional support needs that are leaving school with one or more qualification at SCQF level 5 or better. So there is encouragement in terms of the performance of young people with additional support needs and improvement in performance. But clearly, Mr. McGregor is correct here, that the part of the attainment gap that has to be closed is about relates to the performance of young people with additional support needs. And quite clearly, the focus that can be delivered within schools through pupil equity funding can enable head teachers to take decisions that will directly address the requirements and the circumstances of young people with additional support needs, and to make sure these can be best met as a consequence. So I think there is every opportunity to do that, and of course by the mechanism that we've chosen to do that, that opportunity rests with head teachers to be able to take forward that agenda.
Well, as my other points were covered in the interest of time,
thank you very much. That's Phil McGregor, folks, just in case you didn't know. Yes. Joanne?
Yep. Thanks very much, and thanks very much, Deputy First Minister. I want to ask just a couple of questions about the reality of support for additional support needs in schools. You'll be aware of the Enable report and the report from NASUWT. Do you regard these as legitimate reports in terms of telling us something about what's happening in our schools? Okay. One of the things, I mean, I know what you say about training and so on, and one of the things I think we've picked up in relation to definitions of mainstreaming, and I think, you know, I was there back in the day when the argument made by parents was utterly compelling around the presumption in favour of mainstreaming, that it was the benefit to all young people within a school setting for young people to learn together. But one of the things that's come up is that, first of all, personal support assistants may be well trained, but instead of maybe concentrating on one or two children or one class, are now stretched across two or three classes. Would you regard that as reasonable support? And also that some young people with additional support needs may be in the mainstream, but they're only expected to attend a couple of days a week, a couple of mornings a week, because the supports are not there. Would you regard that as being mainstream education?
That wouldn't strike me as mainstream education, no. And I also don't think it would be, I'm making a general remark here, but you know, it wouldn't strike me as education that would fulfil the potential of young people, because young people have to be given every opportunity to fulfil their potential in every respect. So I think that type of, you have to take the example that John Lamont cites for me of part-time education, essentially is the point that she makes, I don't think is satisfactory. Now, I think I think I probably come at this whole issue from the same perspective as Joanne Lamont, that I believe fundamentally in the principle of mainstreaming. I've seen some fabulous examples of it at work. If I share one anecdote with the committee, I was at St Roch's Primary School in the east end of Glasgow some months ago, and St Roch's includes many children who are hard of hearing. And I went into one class, and as I started to speak to the class about some project work that was on the wall, I was stopped by a boy in the class who came up to me with a loop which I had to put over my head, not for him to be able to hear, but for one of his friends to be able to hear, which I thought was the demonstration of the power of inclusive education, that this young boy was looking after the interests of one of his pals in the class, that he could hear what I was going to say. So I think that's an illustration of where we can see mainstream inclusive education working very effectively. But we have to be satisfied that that is what young people are receiving as their mainstream education. And that's why I think it's important that we have we go through the exercise of looking at the guidance, because we have to be satisfied that the guidance enables local authorities to come to the correct conclusions in partnership with families about what will meet the needs of young people. Because I see enough cases coming to me either as a constituency member of parliament or as the cases that come to me through my ministerial correspondence where families are expressing frustration about that point. And the balance and the judgment about whether the needs of a young person can be met in a mainstream setting or whether they need a different educational setting is a very fine balance to be made, but it should be driven, in my view, by the educational needs of the young person.
So, I mean, Enables Scotland say that truly inclusive education is still far from a reality for young people with learning disabilities. The evidence from the NASUWT and from the evidence we took ourselves is, in fact, mainstreaming is very far from the reality for many young people. And I hear what you're saying about, you know, how effective and how powerful it can be, but there is no doubt there are phenomenal pressures inside schools. Where is that pressure coming from if we accept that local authorities like yourselves and members of this committee are committed in this policy? What's the solution to the part-time education, the personal support assistant over three classes rather than one? I was talking to a hugely experienced primary school teacher, 40 years standing, unbelievably committed professional, who tells me the job has never been as hard as it is now, and the pressure on in the classroom in terms of support you get to deliver your job is immense. What's causing that, and how do we address it?
Well, I think there's a range of different needs within the classroom, and that will be present scenarios that local authorities must make judgments about as to whether or not the appropriate skills and resources are available to support young people in fulfilling their educational potential. So fundamentally, those judgments will be made within schools. Now, of course, and this relates in part to my response to Mr. McGregor's point a second ago, the government has also put in place resources and created an approach which enables schools to have more opportunity to determine what will best meet the needs of young people in their educational setting. And we look to schools and local authorities to work in partnership to deliver on those objectives.
Okay, earlier about the fiscal pressures that you're under, would you accept that local authorities are under resource pressures as a consequence of decisions made by the Scottish Government, and that the resources that are now available to address the support needs of young people are under pressure? Well, therefore, the mainstreaming policy is under pressure. And I wonder if you share my concern that for many young people, their experience of mainstream education is one of failure, and that the danger for the policy is that under those pressures, the young person with additional support needs is seen as the problem. How do we address this question if we're not able to address the whole question of resources to local authorities as part of that consideration?
Well, I think there's two strategic financial points I'll make about the points that John Lamont has raised with me. The first is that in the recent Accounts Commission analysis of the changes in Scottish Government funding, the reductions in Scottish Government funding from the UK Government, and the implications for local authorities in Scotland have largely been of the same magnitude. So in the same way as the government in Scotland has seen reductions in its budget of a particular level, that has largely been reflected in the local authority situation in general. Second strategic financial point I would make is that, so my observation in that is that in challenging budget environments, local authorities have been treated fairly as part of the process. The second strategic financial point is in relation to the education spend of local authorities, which indicated in the last financial year that there was a 2.7% increase in local authority education expenditure, a 1.9% real terms increase in that expenditure. Now, of course, in addition to that, the government has put in place pupil equity funding, which is investing directly in 95% of the schools around the country to ensure that there is new resources to provide additional interventions that will help us to close the poverty-related attainment gap in Scottish education. And that, I think, helps in this respect. And the final point I'd make is back to the point about the attainment and the achievement of young people with additional support needs. Now, I accept that there will be frustration within parents that their young people are not able to achieve all that they think they should be able to achieve because the types of support are not available to young people with additional support needs. But I come back to the statistics that I put on the record earlier on about the rising proportion of young people with additional support needs who are securing qualifications at SCQF level 4 and 5, which are increases over the course of the last few years. And I think that's a welcome indication that young people are fulfilling their potential within the education system in Scotland.
I don't accept the evidence of Enable, NESUWT, the evidence that we've heard, the anecdotal evidence we've heard within our communities, that things are very, very tough in terms of mainstreaming policy, and that there are major challenges been highlighted by teachers and families about the actual support that young people are getting and that teachers and support staff have in order to make the policy work. You don't accept that?
Well, I've said that I take seriously the NESUWT and the Enable reports. I've also indicated that I quite clearly see that there are challenges and there are strains within our education system. But I'm also pointing out to the committee that within this context of financial constraint and the pressures under which we've operated, we can see the achievement of pupils with additional support needs continuing to rise. And I think that's a welcome trend.
Okay, thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. We're going to move on to PSE, but before we do, you mentioned earlier the option for parents to challenge local authority decisions. Can you just clarify for the committee which children can have their cases considered by a tribunal? Because I'm not sure that all children can. Am I right or wrong there?
The tribunal will make its judgments based on the cases that come to it. Obviously, there will be processes to be undertaken through individual local authorities to try to address the issue within the local authority. But fundamentally, the opportunity to go to a tribunal exists if the case passes the tests that are set out in legislation.
Right. Thank you very much. Moving on to the questions on personal and social education, I'd like to ask, the committee wrote to you last week detailing all the ideas that came from a very constructive session that we held on personal and social education. There's clearly some inconsistency in the delivery of PSE, and so the ideas sent to you specifically focus on how this could be improved. I wonder whether you've comments on the potential merits of the ideas raised by the young people who gave evidence last week.
Well, fundamentally, Convener, I'm open to ensuring that we address these issues. Personal and social education covers, as I set out in my earlier remarks, quite a range of different topics, which are essentially distributed through the curriculum under the theme of health and well-being. And health and well-being is one of the three primary curricular areas alongside literacy and numeracy that are deployed across the curriculum. Now, the nature of our curriculum is that we don't have a national template of the curriculum. We don't specify at national level, this must be taught, that must be taught. It is very much up to the teaching profession to formulate the approaches within the classroom that meet the expectations of the guidance around the curriculum. And that's inherent in the thinking behind Curriculum for Excellence. I'm very happy to look at the elements of personal social education and to look at the issues that have been raised with the committee to ensure that we take every step we can to ensure that this education is more consistent and also that it is meaningful to young people in where it is deployed.
Okay, thank you. Ross?
Thanks, Convener. Mr. Swinney, do you believe that every young person gets a sex and relationship education that's relevant to them? Or pitch another way, do you believe that every school delivers relevant and useful sex and relationship education?
It's a very difficult question for me to answer for 2,500 schools in the country. And what I can assure Mr. Greer about is that where inspections are carried out by Education Scotland, before that, in terms of the guidance that we set out, there is very clear guidance on these questions, and particularly around one of the six elements I talked about earlier on was relationships, sexual health and parenthood. So at the guidance level, we expect that to be undertaken in every school in the country. And when it comes to inspection, Education Scotland will be assessing and considering these issues as part of their inspection approach.
The evidence that we've heard as a committee seemed to me to be quite overwhelming, that that's young people are not receiving anything like consistency in sex and relationship education. Almost 9 in 10 LGBT young people, for example, weren't receiving an education that was relevant to them. Huge numbers of young people were not being educated about consent, which seems like an essential principle, a starting principle in that education. But the UK government has this month actually just tabled a bill to make PSHE mandatory, not to specify line by line exactly what every young person is to be taught, but to ensure that there is a minimum standard that all young people are guaranteed. I was wondering what your reaction to that is and if the Scottish government would consider something similar.
Well, we obviously operate in different education systems, and that's my fundamental response to that, that we don't operate on the same education system as prevails in England. My second point is to say that the government attaches great significance to this question, which is why in the direction that was given by the Chief Inspector of Education to all teachers in the country in August of last year, one of the key messages was to prioritise literacy, numeracy and health and well-being across the curriculum to ensure that all learners make the best possible progress. And health and well-being includes that emphasis on relationships, sexual health and parenthood. Now, I've in amongst the points that Mr. Greer made there, he talked about a number of issues around consent, where I unreservedly agree with him about the importance of young people understanding the question of consent. But he also raised the issue of LGBTI young people and what education is available, not just for them, but for all young people about LGBTI issues. And as Mr. Greer will be aware, I have agreed to the request of the Equal Opportunities Committee for them to reflect a bit some further on these questions before the government publishes our further, our updated guidance on relationships, sexual health and parenthood. So ordinarily we would have published that, but the committee asked me to give them an opportunity to reflect some further on that, on that information, and I've happily agreed to that. So what I would say to Mr. Greer is that I think the issues he raises are A, very important, and B, issues that we have to satisfy ourselves that the guidance is effective in that respect. And I suppose that brings me back to answering his fundamental question about the approach that we take. The approach that we take in the Scottish education system is to ensure that the guidance is effective. That is how we assure ourselves that the approach has been taken in a correct fashion within schools, and then that we have the inspection arrangements and mechanisms to ensure that can be followed up.
I accept that Curriculum for Excellence has a flexible approach. I support the Curriculum for Excellence approach, but we should be evidence-led in our policy-making. The evidence in PSE is that a flexible approach is resulting in inconsistencies in areas where essential life skills should be delivered to all young people. But just as a final question, I'd like to ask, PSE, in a lot of our evidence, seemed to come up as something that was undervalued within schools because it's not an assessed subject, because it doesn't feature prominently in inspection reports. How do you believe that we can make PSE more valued within schools, acknowledging that often the issue at the core of this is teacher workload? And when teachers are under pressure, the priority for them is to get young people through assessed subjects.
Well, fundamentally, Curriculum for Excellence, and this is at the top of the requirements of Curriculum for Excellence, is to help young people and children and young people to become successful learners, confident individuals, responsible citizens and effective contributors. Now, we look to the teaching profession to take those aspirations and to turn those aspirations into reality in every one of the 2,500 schools around the country. Now, I fail to be able to see how you can make young people successful learners, confident individuals, responsible citizens and effective contributors without the emphasis on health and well-being that the Chief Inspector of Education has put by saying to every teacher in the country there are three superior curricular areas and they are literacy, numeracy and health and well-being. So I think that if we believe in the structure of our curriculum arrangements, whereby we put in place a framework at national level which sets out the aspirations of what we're trying to achieve to make sure that young people are equipped with the capacities to face the modern world, then we rely on the teaching profession to put that into practice at local level. And I can't see how that can be done convincingly and effectively and meeting the needs of young people without health and wellbeing being central to the approach that we take, which is why it's so prominent in the commentary of the Chief Inspector of Education.
Thank you.
Colin Beattie.
One of the things that struck me when we were taking evidence on this just a week or so ago is the sheer breadth of subjects which were being suggested by people giving evidence, the submissions that were made. And if you look at them in isolation, each one has a validity. Each one would be useful, but clearly there are so many of them, and while some of them might be picked up elsewhere in the curriculum, a great many of them aren't. We're saying that we're not going to be prescriptive necessarily to local councils who or local schools who determine these. Should there be some subjects that are mandatory? Should there be some subjects where, you know, they have to prioritise?
I think that's reflected in the answer I've just given to Mr. Greer in what the Chief Inspector of Education has set out to the teaching profession, because there are a range of there's eight curricular areas within Curriculum for Excellence, but the Chief Inspector is crystal clear in his documentation that planning should prioritise. Literacy, numeracy and health and well-being across the curriculum. So that prioritisation is being made in the direction that the Chief Inspector of Education has given. So I think it's important that in doing so, that is reinforced by there being clarity about what one might expect to find in health and wellbeing. I think this is part of Mr. Greer's point about the consistency that applies across the country. And it's important that that's reflected in all circumstances, so that having attached that priority to health and wellbeing, it's followed through within the schools and across the country.
Given the, as I said, the validity of many of these other aspects that we would like to see people trained in, or at least educated in, is there a danger that we're expecting teachers to cover too many subjects, perhaps, in this? I wouldn't see teachers would have all those skills, all the training necessary to deliver on each and every item that's being put forward. And even if you distill it down to a smaller number, it's still a big ask.
There are obviously opportunities for teachers to deliver these elements of the curriculum, or they are able to bring in resources and external parties that may well make an impression on some of these questions. And you see around the country some very interesting projects whereby schools are inviting external organisations to come into the school to provide education on certain issues, for example, like substance misuse, where there can be very effective communication and education to young people from external organisations, which teachers facilitate, but which give young people the type of insight that would be beneficial to them. And obviously, Curriculum for Excellence is structured in a fashion to encourage and to motivate that to be the case.
I suppose the other thing is that there is a limited amount of time allocated by schools for PSE, which, by the very nature of that, limits the number of subjects that can be discussed.
I don't think we should just look at these issues being fulfilled by the amount of time that's allocated to PSE, because there will be, one of the points, again, going back to the Chief Inspector's guidance, is that health and wellbeing is identified as a responsibility of all within the school. So it's not just about what do you do in your allocated time on PSE. There will be various ways in which, throughout the curriculum, there is the opportunity for young people to have experience of issues around health and wellbeing, which will meet the expectations of the curriculum.
Thank you very much, Gillian. And then Ross Thompson.
Right, before I start, I must declare an interest in my husband's a guidance teacher. And my question is about the training for guidance teachers and how that may be a route into addressing some of the problems that the young people who spoke to us had about PSE. Because there seems to be an inconsistency in the quality and training of guidance teachers. I think particularly given that most teachers have actually gone into secondary teaching to do a subject and then become guidance teachers later on. Is there something that we could address in terms of teacher training where we have anybody who's going in to teach guidance maybe has to do some kind of specific course in order to be able to qualify to become a guidance teacher? Because I have to say that one of the things that I've spoken to my colleagues about is that becoming a guidance teacher is often seen as a route into management for some people, when in fact becoming a guidance teacher should be something that a person opts to do because they want to be a guidance teacher and they want to be effective in PSE. So I'm interested to know your thoughts on that.
I think one of my general priorities is to strengthen the focus on continuous professional development within education, and a lot of the steps that I'm taking to declutter the curriculum and to reduce the volume of advice and bureaucracy is to actually create the space and the capacity for teachers to be able to take forward continuous professional development. So therefore, that's a general priority, and I think the specific priority that Gillian Martin makes in relation to guidance professionals is an important and appropriate point to make sure that those individuals are equipped to support young people as effectively as they can in assisting their well-being. And obviously there is likely to be a carryover of that into the issues around PSE, into additional support needs that we've just considered a moment ago.
I mean, that, and when we were talking about additional support needs, we talked about how you are speaking with the GTC and education colleges on how teacher training can maybe be adapted to best reflect the increase in demand for ASN. But as I think what was thrown up the other week when we were talking at PSE is that PSE training perhaps needs to be given some kind of boost or overhaul, or to be able to adapt to the new circumstances that we find around, especially around things around consent, the use of online, social media, and all those issues that are thrown up as a result of that.
I think, as I've indicated already in my answers, I'm really quite open to this question. We had been planning some further guidance on relationships, sexual health and parenthood, but you know, committees have asked me to provide them with the opportunity to reflect on that a bit further, and I've agreed to that. So, you know, I would have expected that to be available by now, but you know, I'm very happy to engage parliamentary committees on this question. But I think there's a wider issue that the committee's work and inquiry may open up, which I'm certainly very happy to consider.
Okay, and I think it would be remiss of us if we're talking PSE, we didn't actually reference some of the evidence from Jordan Daly from the TIE campaign, who said the obvious elephant in the room is faith schools and their position and what they're prepared to teach. It's not acceptable to continue opt-outs on moral grounds, as there are LGBT young people in faith schools that don't have the same kind of PSE provision that you maybe get in other schools. And I think that's an issue that, I mean, it's obviously controversial, but I think that's something that may be to be looked at.
I think it's an issue that we need to be mindful of. It's important that young people are equipped to deal with the modern world, and the faith schools in Scotland have a particular perspective and I've about how to equip young people with the knowledge and the awareness to address the world in which we live. And I think we have to work collaboratively and constructively with faith schools to ensure that young people are equipped in the best way possible to deal with the challenges of the world as they find it.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Gillian Tavish.
Supplementary, convener, just on Gillian Martin's very sensible last point there. I think the evidence we got was that the faith schools were not equipping young people, and that's the point. I'm sure I understand the need for the Cabinet Secretary to be intensely tactful in this area, but I think he may wish to reflect on the evidence. I actually wanted to ask a question related to her earlier point about guidance teachers. Do you think, Cabinet Secretary, there is a role for guidance staff to actually have a much broader range of skills than just being teachers? In other words, a social work background, a youth work background, particularly in the context of PSE and the rather alarming evidence that Ross Greer was citing earlier this morning?
Yeah, I think there's I think there may be a case for that, and certainly something to consider. I think there's also the other way to look at this is about how guidance staff can be essentially the facilitators of some of those skills coming together to meet the needs of young people, which may, I think it might be quite difficult to recruit individuals who would pass the matrix that Mr. Scott just talked about of education, social work, community development backgrounds. I think it'd be quite difficult to get that breadth. But what I do think is possible is that guidance staff will be able to establish the connections with other professionals who should be able to work together to meet the needs of young people within a school setting, and to put together a proposition in terms of the delivery of health and wellbeing within the curriculum that actually fulfils what I think we all would like to see delivered in this respect. So it may be that that can't be embodied in one individual, but I do think guidance staff need to be well connected to enable that to be delivered.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Ross. And then Ross Greer.
Ross Greer's question, just for a bit of clarification. In your answer to Ross Greer, you spoke about the guidance that's available to schools. My understanding is that it's not a requirement on schools to act upon that. So do you have any idea in terms of how many schools are actually delivering on the guidance, and maybe how many schools aren't?
I think in a sense it comes back to the question that Ross Greer asked me, which is, you know, can I be certain something is happening in 2,500 schools in the country? I can't give a definitive answer to that question. What I can say is the government puts in place the framework and the guidance, and we rely on teaching professionals the length and breadth of the country to implement that and to apply that within their educational setting.
Very briefly, Convener, thank you. Following on from Julian Martin's point as well, in his evidence to the committee, Jordan Daly stated that 86% of LGBT people reported that LGBT issues were never discussed or taught in their schools. And I don't know if the Cabinet Secretary is aware, but even yesterday there was another press report about a young boy of 14 committing suicide. Now, I urge caution that we don't know the reasons, but it was reported that it's because he recently came out as gay and had severe bullying at school. So I suppose I asked the Cabinet Secretary, not as an MSP or a member of the committee, but I asked personally as someone who's been through the same kind of bullying for just being bullied for who I was, is there any intention with the government to act on with some urgency? I appreciate what he's doing in relation to Equal Opportunities Committee, but will there be any urgency from the government on this particular issue?
First of all, Convener, can I say that I have seen the press reports that to which Mr. Thomson refers, and the committee will understand I'm not in a position to express any comment other than to say that I express my deepest sympathy to the family of the young man in question, and I cannot imagine what they are experiencing just now. On his substantive point about bullying is reprehensible in whatever shape or form it takes place, and we have a very clear expectation on the education system to tackle bullying and to support young people in all of their needs and that they have. We are looking very carefully at the issues that have been raised by the Thai campaign. I willingly agreed to the request of the Equal Opportunities Committee to look further at this question, and you know, and I'll move as quickly as I possibly can do on these questions. We want to make sure that we get this approach correct, because fundamentally, you know, there is a statutory obligation on schools to follow the guidance that we set out. So we want to make sure, given the fact that Parliament has created a statutory environment around this question, that that is the expectation of what young people experience within the school system.
Thanks. Very briefly on Gillian Martin's last point, Cabinet Secretary, do you believe it is acceptable for a school not to teach LGBT young people about their own lives, their own identity, if that school has some kind of moral issue with it?
I think it's important that young people are equipped to face the world and to be equipped to know themselves and to be able to know their own sexuality and to have an awareness of all questions of sexuality. So they must be equipped to enable that to be the case.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Cabinet Secretary. We will now move on to questions on the delivery of Curriculum for Excellence. And I'll start off with Liz Smith.
Thank you, Convener. Mr. Swinney, could I just ask you about the letter that you sent to the committee last week, and particularly about the criticism that you've levelled at the committee for some of the evidence. You've made the point very strongly that you don't believe that it was based on an assessment of sufficiently broad evidence, and I note that that's been reported in the newspaper this morning, The Times. You go on to make the point that because it was only dealing with 1% of Scotland's publicly employed teaching workforce, you feel that that was very biased, really, basically. Do you accept, however, that that was only one part of quite a lot of evidence that we received, particularly in terms of the representations that have been made to us by bodies who represent quite a number of teachers, for example, the geographers, the modern studies people, the computing people, plus a number of the teaching unions, and also quite a number of people who have had observations on education, particularly on the Curriculum for Excellence. Do you think that that comment was a particularly wise one?
The first thing I want to say is at no stage have I used the word biased. So I want that clearly understood by the committee. At no stage have I used the word biased. That was Liz Smith's word and it's not one that I've used.
It's one reported in the press.
Pardon?
I said I think it's one that's been reported in the press.
Well, it's not one word that you will appear that will appear in any communication I have made, so I don't want it associated with me, and I put that on the record firmly to the committee. Now, what I've said is that the committee's reliance on the survey is, to me, not indicative of taking a balanced view of all of the evidence that's available, given the fact that the education organisations themselves commission feedback from members of the public, from individuals with whom they interact, which provides different perspectives on the performance and the impact of these organisations. So, for example, on Education Scotland, the surveys that are carried out after inspections, the overwhelming majority, if my memory serves me right, it is possibly in excess of 85% of respondents indicate that they felt their school was enhanced as a consequence of the Education Scotland intervention through inspection. And that, to me, is counterbalancing evidence that the committee should weigh up in coming to the conclusions that it came to.
Mr. Swinney, you're obviously not able to be present because of the focus groups that were organised through private session. But both myself and Joanne Lamont chaired these sessions some 3 weeks ago. And there was very strong representation made to us in these private sessions, which I can't obviously go into the details because of the nature of the private sessions. But they made clear to us once again the depth of feeling, which backs up quite a lot of the evidence that we took, particularly when it came to the formal committee sessions that we had with SQA and Education Scotland. And it certainly backs up a lot of the anecdotal evidence that we all receive as MSPs visiting schools just now. Do you accept that there is very strong representation being made to yourself and to Parliament that the delivery of the curriculum for excellence has fundamental problems that need to be addressed? Do you accept that?
No.
Could you explain on what basis you believe that that's not correct?
Well, to assist me in delivering the answer, I would be grateful if Liz Smith would explain to me the basis of the criticism of curriculum for excellence.
Yes, absolutely. I mean, the point that's being put to us by the groups that I mentioned earlier is that the actual delivery of the curriculum for excellence is confused. You yourself has been a person who has commissioned the abolition of, I think, something like 20,000 sheets of the guidance because you rightly thought that it was confusing and not in the best interest of directing teachers. And the basic problem for many of the teachers just now is that to approach the fundamental principles of the curriculum for excellence, which we all agree are good ones, that has got lost because the delivery of the curriculum for excellence has been clouded in considerable difficulty. Now, that is a very strong message that we are getting from, I would say, a very considerable majority of the people who speak to us. And therefore, I'm struggling to find a reason as to why you think that that's not correct.
Well, we're going to have a difference of opinion about all this because I take a fundamentally different view of this to Liz Smith. I've come into office 9 months ago with a very open mind about many of these questions, and I've looked carefully at what has happened over the years to get to where we are today. And essentially, there has been a build-up of guidance over a number of years, which has been requested by the education system for it to be put in place. And all of the steps, if we go through it, the discussions around this have been collaborative discussions involving the teaching profession as represented by the professional associations, the education agencies, the government, local authorities, directors of education, professional advisors in academic and curriculum development have all worked collaboratively as part of this process and presiding over the growing volume of guidance that has been available to members of the teaching profession. Now, what I've done since I've come into office is looked very hard at that and required very clear and definitive guidance to be issued to every teacher in the country, which is this guidance. And the feedback I get, and, you know, some of it's in big formal gatherings. In other occasions, it's when I'm walking around schools and teachers will stop me and tell me that this guidance has helped to clarify the direction of the curriculum. Or when I'm, I think I've recounted this to the committee before, when I'm standing on the pier at the Tarbert Ferry Terminal in the Western Isles, a teacher coming up to me to say that guidance has helped improve the way in which they can deliver curriculum for excellence. So my point is that guidance has grown up at each stage of the development of curriculum for excellence, and we have now got to the point where we need to provide the definitive clarity that will assist the teaching profession, and I am in the process of delivering that. Now, the next bit, the bit that went with this was the delivery of literacy and numeracy benchmarks, which was to give clarity to the teaching profession about what was expected of them at different stages in the journey of young people through the education system. And that has, in my opinion, generally been well received by the teaching profession. It's supported by the professional associations and is viewed to be having an effect in the system. And I'm, having listened to the professional associations, I'm going to issue benchmarks that will relate to other areas of the curriculum beyond literacy and numeracy before the end of March, which I've discussed with the professional associations to make sure there is absolute clarity for the teaching profession about what they're expected to deliver. So, in short, I think that over the years, a number of steps have been taken to provide the guidance that the profession was looking for, and we are now in the process of focusing that guidance in the most effective way we can. Now, the final thing I'll say about this is that is to talk about the view of the OECD, who concluded, and this is in their statement of 15th of December 2016, "We applaud Scotland for having the foresight and patience to put such an ambitious reform as Curriculum for Excellence in place. We hope that our OECD review will help ensure that it will live up to its full potential and realise excellence and equity right across Scotland. And the National Improvement Framework, over which I preside, is designed to deliver against that expectation of the OECD review that the Curriculum for Excellence should live up to its full potential."
Cabinet Secretary, my final point on this, if that's all true, you make your assertion in paragraph 3 on page 2 of the letter that you write to us that you don't understand why members of this committee are unclear about the lines of responsibility for decisions on all matters pertaining to national education policy. You say that the buck stops with you. I think we all understand that. And you say that your colleague, Fiona Robertson, made it very clear to us about how decisions are made. I have to tell you, Cabinet Secretary, and I hope I speak for many members round the table, we found it incredibly difficult to get out of the education agencies exactly who makes a decision, on what basis, and who is finally responsible for that decision. I think my colleague Tavish Scott will maybe say a bit more about this. He quite rightly pointed to the fact that for 9 years there has been a Curriculum for Excellence board, and it has been very difficult indeed to get any understanding as to how decisions were made, on what basis, and who was ultimately responsible for it. Is that not the basic problem about the Curriculum for Excellence just now?
No, I don't think it's the problem. There may be... Scottish education is a collaborative endeavour. And I may have been through this. Forgive me if I'm repeating things I've said to the committee over the times I've been here, but you know, I speak on these subjects all the time. If I want to have a discussion about charting a way forward in Scottish education, I will not be able to have... This would be a smallish gathering. I don't think I would get away with a gathering as small as this, because of the number of stakeholders that need to be assembled around the table, between professional associations, local authorities, specialist directors of education, local authority chief executives, professional advisors, our agencies. They've all got to be around the table. Let's take the assessment and qualifications group around that table. I chair it, and I'm only chairing it because I want to get some movement on this as quickly as possible. I chair it. The government's there. Education Scotland's there. The SQA's there. The EIS, the SSTA, the NESUWT, School Leaders Scotland, academic advisors from the University of Glasgow, the University of Strathclyde, ADES, parents, National Parent Forum for Scotland, the colleges, the universities. I actually wasn't counting as I went around my fingers. I think it was at 17 there. Or
the point is, now, who takes responsibility right, for the decisions?
But I'm coming to that. So that's my explanation. There are many, many stakeholders that have to be brought together. But my letter couldn't be clearer. I am accountable to the First Minister and to the Scottish Parliament for those decisions. Ultimately, I carry responsibility for this. And I sit here and I accept that responsibility and I articulate it. But the fact that it may suit Liz Smith's narrative every so often to suggest that I'm a man of immense power that can dictate this, that, and the next thing to happen around the country. I've got to take a lot of people with me in coming to the conclusions and the decisions that I arrive at. Because this is not anything other than a collaborative endeavour. Now, ultimately, some decisions have to be taken when not everybody is in agreement. And sometimes this committee will get some of the swell from that. It will hear from people who don't agree with decisions that have been taken. But, you know, in the committee's evidence paper that's circulated for today, at one point, the committee cites one head teacher saying you should do 8 qualifications at NAT 5, and the next paragraph cites a head teacher saying you should do 6 at NAT 5. Now, I don't say this to be critical of the committee. The committee is simply marshalling the fact that there's a wide variety of different views about what to do. In my old days in finance, you know, once you allocated the money, you allocated the money and you explained that was it. But here, there is a debate, a necessary debate about all range of questions. So there will be a lot of debate. There will be a lot of different opinions, but ultimately, we have to navigate a way through it. Now, Curriculum for Excellence, in its original intention, this comes back to some of what I said to Mr. Greer earlier on today, Curriculum for Excellence was not designed to be a curriculum that was delivered uniformly in every school in the country in the same way that it's undertaken. And if Liz Smith was a supporter of the principles of Curriculum for Excellence, which she's just told me that she is, then she accepts that point, that it's not delivered in the same fashion. So there's going to be variation, there will be difference, but fundamentally, Curriculum for Excellence is driven by the work that goes on in every school to achieve the 4 capacities of successful learners, confident individuals, responsible citizens, and effective contributors.
Mr. Swinney, my point is not that, of course, there'll be debate, and of course you have to make difficult decisions, government ministers do. The point is, what we would like to know as a committee is, when a decision is made, on what basis was it made, and through what process in the management board was the decision taken? And if there is a problem, if there's a wealth of teachers that are concerned about that, you know, we've got unions telling us that they'll rather go to the minister than they would to the Curriculum for Excellence Board. That's the problem we've got, is that the lines of responsibility are blurred. And when it comes down to a body of opinion where people are obviously not entirely happy with the Curriculum for Excellence, it's very difficult to see the way through as to how to resolve it. That's my point.
Let's take, for example, the issue on the changes to the national qualifications that are currently underway. The Assessment and Qualifications Group considered this issue in detail, round the table. We got to a point in that discussion where there was, with a number of papers having been put to us, where there was a conclusion that the removal of unit assessment was the right thing to do at NAT 5 and higher. That paper and its contents were put to the Curriculum for Excellence Management Board, who agreed those provisions. There's an example. And I accepted the view of the Curriculum for Excellence Management Board, and that's being implemented. Now, if that's that, well, there's an illustration of how a decision is taken.
Colleagues, come
in. We'll move on to Tavish. Tavish.
Thank you very much, Convener. This morning, the Times is reporting that you judge our paper to be unbalanced. Is that factually accurate? I just want to be very clear about terminology, so I do not put words in your mouth. Is unbalanced the correct phrase?
That's the word that I've used in my letter, yes.
Thank you. Can I just clarify whether your concern about us being the committee being unbalanced is in relation to our recommendations on Education Scotland and the SQA, or is it wider than that?
My view is in your... let me just, for the avoidance of doubt, let me just have the words in front of me. I'm referring specifically to the areas in connection with the SQA and Education Scotland.
It's quite important to clarify that. Can I just take you to the third page of your letter to the committee, in which you say at the top paragraph, of course, separate unique responsibilities for implementation of CFE reside with the delivery bodies and the board, by which I presume that to be the Curriculum for Excellence Management Board, has played a key role in holding these organisations, which I take to be Education Scotland and the SQA, to account for those responsibilities. Would you be able to give us some examples, the committee, some examples of exactly that? Because that's what we're trying to tease out in the meeting we had on the 18th of January.
Essentially, the management board, for example, would be taking a decision of a strategic nature to, let's take the live one, to remove the unit's assessment. Essentially, the management board would say, well, we've taken that decision. We now want to see that implemented by the Scottish Qualifications Authority and to make sure that's done in a fashion that it satisfies the objectives of the Curriculum for Excellence Management Board. Now, the Curriculum for Excellence Management Board must be mindful of the status of the SQA in being able to take its own internal processes and decide its resourcing requirements and all the rest of it. But fundamentally, the management board is looking to the SQA to deliver on the policy choice that's been made.
So therefore, why did Larry Flanagan say again in his evidence to us that the teacher workload issues were only addressed when he and his union went direct to ministers, one of your predecessors, not you, Minister, one of your predecessors, despite many discussions at the management board? In other words, they felt they got nowhere at the management board and had to take it offline directly to the minister.
That's a question for Mr. Flanagan. I can't interpret his comments in that respect. It's not appropriate for me to
evidence,
do so.
Mr. Swinney, was that things started to happen with your predecessor, Mr. Russell, when the EIS spoke to Mr. Russell, and Mr. Russell, responded positively to that, but they got nowhere when they raised it time and time again in the management board.
Well, I can't comment on Mr. Flanagan's behalf.
It's something I
think that's something that you'd be best place to put to Mr. Flanagan.
Well, we did, and his evidence, which of course you will have read, is on the record. Similarly, he said that in relation to the SQA and to Education Scotland, they would publish guidance in Education Scotland's case, or with the SQA, new exam material was regularly sent to schools without the involvement or joined-up communication involving the management board. I mean, we were under the impression the management board was there to manage the process of implementing Curriculum for Excellence, and the evidence we got is that just did not work effectively.
Mm. Well, that is what the structure is designed to achieve, to ensure that there is a cohesive approach to the implementation of all of these questions.
But
in accordance with the implementation plan,
yeah,
that all organisations had signed up to as part of the implementation of Curriculum for Excellence.
But would you accept that the committee found legitimate areas of concern as to where the management board hadn't functioned as any of us would understand a management board to function in respect of implementing something so fundamentally important as curriculum for excellence?
Fundamentally, the management board has to bring together the different and disparate views of organisations involved in the process, and not everybody is going to be comfortable with every single bit of detail. And there are, you know, there are differences of view around a management board, and ultimately a management board will have to come to a conclusion about how to proceed.
It's pretty fundamental, the publication of the enormous amount of guidance, which we've given you credit for. Many of us across politics have given you credit for tackling from September of last year onwards. The enormous amount that Liv Smith referred to grew and grew and grew during the period. Now, you'll rightly say back to me, teachers in many cases were asking for that, but it grew and grew and grew, and the evidence we got was that at no time did the management board look at that and say, gosh, more and more is coming, so we need to take some off at the bottom end to give teachers some space to teach here.
Well, I think you know, it's interesting. I obviously I've taken steps to reduce the volume of material that's there, and I received some very direct criticism from some members of the teaching profession direct to me about some of the stuff that had been removed. So the challenge here is to navigate our way through providing the clarity that is required for the teaching profession, but also remembering that one of the key objectives of Curriculum for Excellence is to empower the teaching profession to make their own judgments about how best to deliver the curriculum in the settings in which they are operating.
And that is indeed true. So that reinforces the OECD's finding that you've already cited this morning and cited many times in the past from their report of 2015, which I reread last night, when they said the complexity of the layers and dimensions when all put together raises its own questions about how comprehensible is the curriculum for excellence. That was their finding on page 44 of their 2015 report. What did the management board do about that fundamental finding about the complexity teachers are facing?
Well, what the management board was doing was essentially responding to the demand for guidance that was emerging from the profession at different stages in the journey. And what I've done is I have established a very clear focus within the guidance that is available about what should structure the decision making that is undertaken by teachers. Now, if we take, for example, some of the framework of Curriculum for Excellence for experiences and outcomes, and in some circumstances, that was being interpreted as being a tick box exercise that literally every single experience and outcome had to be proven to be delivered to every pupil in the country. That's a colossal bureaucratic exercise, total nonsense. But that was allowed to emerge through local practice. And what I've tried to do with the guidance is to give the clarity that says experiences and outcomes, for example, are the context of learning. But what we need to be satisfied by, which will be delivered by the benchmarks, is these are the levels that we expect young people to reach, and teachers should be confident of getting young people to those levels.
I absolutely accept that. I thought it's important on the record to remember that there were 1,820 experiences and outcomes across 1,488 in eight curriculum areas. So that again was the OECD's findings.
But this is where I appreciate the calculation, well, the numbers that Mr. Scott cites, but what that is doing is applying that to the whole curriculum over all the subject areas,
yes, indeed,
over all the years involved.
Yeah, sure.
Now, I've been a wee bit round the houses with this with Mr. Scott before about benchmarks, for example, where I think Mr. Scott was brandishing a document in Parliament of the volume
brandishing
of benchmarks.
Waving
is maybe a slightly less
pejorative
remark, but Mr. Scott was waving a document at me, which was a vast volume of benchmarks. And yes, they are the benchmarks for the whole system, but for a teacher dealing with an individual classroom, only a fraction are those benchmarks are relevant. So whilst we wave big documents around, there are only parts of them that from time to time can be relevant at one particular moment in the education system.
Well, perish the thought that I wave any more, but let me finish with two final points. You mentioned to Liz Smith that you were going to introduce new benchmarks. I'm sure you won't brandish them. I'm sure you'll just introduce them before the end of the March. Can we have an assurance that those new benchmarks will replace some of the existing benchmarks guidance information, for want of a better expression, that is currently in front of teachers in those specific curriculum areas that you are about to introduce?
Yeah, well, there's an exercise that is very close to completion, which is looking at putting in place the clarity of what the teaching profession is expected to achieve in the areas out with literacy and numeracy that we've already published. And those are designed to give the clarity that will be required. And in the Chief Inspector of Education's circular to practitioners, he makes it clear that the two key resources which teachers should use to plan learning, teaching and assessment are experiences and outcomes and benchmarks. And that's the essential clarity that all members of the teaching profession will require.
Thank you. And finally, can I just relate to you to one of the other paragraphs in our report that we published earlier in relation to teachers themselves, when the committee said, teachers may feel inhibited from expressing critical and independent views as suggested by the Royal Society of Edinburgh. The committee is determined that it should have access to the candid views of teachers and frontline staff who have valuable contributions to make to its scrutiny. I hope you might share, not just my, but I suspect the committee's concerns about the fact that we did have to ask for teachers to come forward, and many said that they would only do that anonymously in giving evidence to our committee. I mean, that alone says there's something quite wrong with the culture of teaching across Scotland. Would you at least accept that we've got some issues to address if that's the
way
which people have to
express themselves? I want to have an empowered profession.
I agree.
An empowered teaching profession. Mm-hmm. And I can cite to the committee a regular flow of communication I receive directly from teachers with their names on it, directly to me as Education Secretary, often through my MSP inbox, and I get lots of communication from teachers. And yes, some of it is critical of decisions that have been taken, because there are different views about what is the right step to take forward. So I want to have an empowered profession. I've just put in place pupil equity funding, which I think will be seen in a few years' time as being one of the most empowering things that we have done for the teaching profession, to give greater scope and leadership into the profession. I hear directly from teachers. I speak to teachers face-to-face without management present when I'm in visiting schools. I know the teachers' names. They speak to me very freely about issues. And yes, there are challenging conversations within that, because there are differences of view about what are the right steps to take forward in education.
About you at all, Cabinet Secretary. I think it's about Education Scotland and the SQA. I think what we're getting is that teachers were frightened to put their names to their concerns about the operation of the quangos that they have to deal with. That was, I think, the main point we picked up as a committee.
I don't see any. A justification for that whatsoever. Okay. We should have curriculum for excellence is designed to create an empowered profession, and that's what I want it to do.
Okay, thank you.
Fulton, you've got a supplementary.
I'd hinted for the supplementary before Tavish's last point, but it's kind of similar to that. Given the weight of opinion that the committee did here, and given that I think runs counter to what I experience in my local schools and what the Cabinet Secretary is saying that he also experiences, does the Cabinet Secretary think it's possible that the committee has become a forum for those most disheartened with the process? Because I think we could all accept, as politicians particularly, that that we're more likely to get responses from people that are critical than those who are positive and think things that are going well. So I wonder if the Cabinet Secretary would think that that's been a possibility, and if it is, what could be done within Education Scotland, SQA, and at a local authority level, so that these people's voices are heard more locally and that they're feeling they're getting a chance to affect change?
Well,
I accept a point to Tavish Scott's
Cabinet Secretary. Well, I make the point in my response to the committee, convener, that I expect the highest standards of all public bodies contributing to the education and skills agenda within Scotland. And I expect the SQA and Education Scotland to engage with the teaching profession and to take the views and the feedback seriously. And that's my position, and I want us to have an open dialogue about these points. But of course, you know, there does come a point where we have to come to decisions, and not everybody's going to like all those decisions.
Thank you, Daniel. I'd like to return to, I think, the structures, and particularly curriculum for excellence management board. And I think, you know, it's fair to say probably the committee has had some questions around that. So I'd just really like to ask you, in terms of the design of the curriculum and also the responsibility for sort of monitoring how successfully implementation is taking place, how do you see the respective responsibilities of yourself as Cabinet Secretary, Curriculum for Excellence Management Board, the SQA and Education Scotland in terms of those key issues?
Well, let me take it in reverse.
Yeah.
The Scottish Qualifications Authority has got a very, very specific responsibility, which in my view is twofold. One is to preside over an authoritative certification and examination process in Scotland for our qualifications. And secondly, to contribute towards the wider educational process in Scotland. Education Scotland has got the responsibility to carry out the inspections that are required by statute and its statutory role in that respect, and it has to provide me with advice on educational issues and educational practice, and then it has to contribute to the general education debate and discussion. The Curriculum for Excellence Management Board was created with a responsibility to essentially coordinate the implementation of Curriculum for Excellence over a number of years gestation, and it would obviously draw on the input of the SQA and Education Scotland, but as I rehearsed in my answer to Liz Smith a moment ago, it would draw on the input of a whole range of other stakeholders as part of the process. And ultimately, the Curriculum for Excellence Management Board would give the Education Secretary advice, guidance, recommendations. And ultimately, the responsibility rests with the Education Secretary.
Thank you for that answer.
And for completeness, could I just say, and I possibly should have said this in my earlier answers, I have already told the committee that I am looking at whether or not these arrangements remain appropriate on an ongoing basis, and I will consider that as part of the governance review.
Thank you, and I appreciate that fact. I mean, I think one of the issues that I think we identified and were asking about is really around the design of the qualification system and how well that integrated with the broad general education, in particular, the 160 hours and the requirements that places on schools and what that meant in terms of the breadth of subjects that pupils were able to take. Now, the reality of those impacts to one side. I mean, those responsibilities in terms of the design, both in terms of the hours required for those qualifications, and then importantly, the impact on what that means in terms of breadth. Whose responsibility is that, that breadth and the kind of the deliverability?
This is not going to be a short answer.
No, I didn't expect it to be.
He's incited a very long answer. And if the committee will be patient with me, I'll try and work, because it is Mr. Johnson's point is an entirely valid point, and I want to try to do it justice. The assumption of Curriculum for Excellence is that the broad general education will deliver capability and capacity of young people to a certain level, and essentially the benchmarks which I am now going to put in place for at the end of this month will make that absolutely crystal clear across all subject areas. So if there's any doubt around the country about what is expected of the broad general education to establish as the competence of a young person, that'll be clarified beyond peradventure in the course of this month. Young people then move into the senior phase, and the design of qualifications essentially reflects assumptions of what's been acquired as the knowledge of young people in the broad general education, and then the specifics of what they're required to do in the senior phase. Now, Mr. Johnson raises the 160 hours, which I think is perfectly entitled to raise it, but I'm not. I think the 160 hours is the SQ assessment of how many hours a student needs to do to complete a qualification. I think the danger of how that's been interpreted is that everyone takes the view that the clock of the 160 hours starts at the end of the broad general education, when in fact, logically, there must be capacities and capabilities that have been acquired during the broad general education that act as foundations to what will then contribute to elements of the senior phase and the 160 hours, if I call it that. And I think that has an effect on some of the planning that schools undertake as to what are the choices and the approaches that young people take, and we've got different models that exist around the country. And fundamentally, schools are free to choose those different models, although, you know, on occasions I have been questioned about whether or not it would be appropriate for the government to specify how many subject choices should be there in whatever circumstances. So fundamentally, the senior phase has got to be built on the capacities and the capabilities that have been acquired in the broad general education and decisions taken at school level about how that should be applied given the interests and the perspectives of young people.
That actually helpfully, I think, anticipates what my follow-up question was going to be. I mean, I think there are two things which have been reported to us, and I'm far from claiming this is what happens everywhere, but certainly they have been made regarding kind of S3 and what happens and consequences thereafter. And I think one is, I think the point that you allude to there is that some schools are starting to teach National 4-5 in S3 in order to kind of get through the 160 hours. Now, it'd be interesting to know, based on the answer you just given, whether or not actually think that's a valid thing to do.
Mr. Johnson, you know, raises an interesting point, but I want to be absolutely crystal clear of what I said. What I'm saying is that I think within the broad general education, there will be elements of learning that will contribute towards National 4, as opposed to schools should be teaching National 4 in S3. Just to make that absolutely clear.
That's a helpful clarification, and I think answers that point. I mean, the other issue that has been flagged in our work is that in some instances, in some schools, in order to timetable subjects, that they have composite classes where National 4, 5, and indeed higher are being taught in a single class. Now, I mean, would you agree with me that is a signal that there may be sort of design issues and deliverability issues that require further investigation? And would you agree with me that doesn't sound like an ideal way of teaching any of those qualifications, let alone kind of a subject in its entirety?
Well, I think some of the judgment about that, and I'd be happy to explore further detail about this, but I think some of the judgment about that will relate to what's the, you know, pupil numbers and the extent to which distinctive classes can be put in place for distinctive cohorts, and that you know, sort of school size and rurality may have an effect on some of that into the bargain. But fundamentally, teachers will be accustomed to and equipped to teach at multiple levels, and I certainly have seen successful practice in which that can be deployed. But I'm happy to explore whether there's a systemic issue that lies at the heart of that question.
Okay. And in terms of responsibility for these issues, in terms of how easy or how easily the qualifications are to deliver within the timescale set out, I mean, ultimately, is that the Curriculum for Excellence Management Board's responsibility? And if it's not, where does that integration and responsibility lie, in your view, you know, with that structure that you outlined at the beginning?
Well, ultimately, I come back to Mr. Johnson's original question to me, which was a who does what question. And on the issues around the certification and authority of qualifications, that is the exclusive responsibility of the Scottish Qualifications Authority. And it can be, you know, the Management Board doesn't supervise the qualification decisions of the SQA on individual candidates. That is the statutory duty of the SQA, and nobody, not even a minister, can interfere in that process. But what I, when I answered Mr. Johnson in his original question, I said that the SQA had a responsibility to undertake that certification and authorisation process within the qualifications, but they also had a role to contribute towards the wider educational discussion. Now, let me give a practical example of that. In formulating the benchmarks that will be issued in the course of this month, I've said to the Chief Executive of Education Scotland and the Chief Executive of the SQA, I want there to be, if I'm allowed to use the analogy, not a cigarette paper between the judgment of the SQA about what they're expecting candidates to be able to achieve at the end of the broad general education and what Education Scotland puts into those benchmarks. So they must be totally, they must have the same view about what must be the capacity and capability of candidates at the end of the broad general education. So that's an example of how those organisations need to work very, very intimately together to make sure that the right conclusion is arrived at.
Yeah, just last question. I mean, I'm sure the Cabinet Secretary would agree with me that breadth is one of the enduring qualities of the Scottish education system and something that should be maintained. And again, I think breadth is one of these things which is there's a lot of indicators that you could point to. But one bit of evidence that I've looked at is the number of students sitting and passing modern language qualifications in senior, and with, there's been a quite precipitous drop, falls of around, you know, over 40% in French and German. I mean, does he think that warrants further investigation into what's going on there? Is that something he's concerned about? And indeed, is breadth something generally that he's taking active consideration to look at actually what the picture is, given the changes in the education system over recent years?
Well, breadth is fundamental. Yes, I agree with that, and that is why the broad general education. That's why the broad general education is what it is within Curriculum for Excellence, to provide that breadth for every learner in Scotland. When it then comes into the senior phase and the point that Mr. Johnson raises about qualifications, obviously we have. You know, we'll have different patterns of performance on particular subjects, and we need to explore. Mr. Johnson cites modern languages. We have challenges on STEM as well. So we have to explore where we are not getting sufficient candidates emerging to meet the needs of our society. So, of course, we look actively at these questions, and then we intervene to try to boost interest and participation as effectively as we can.
Thank you very much. Ross, you were wanting to come in.
Very briefly on the Curriculum for Excellence Management Board, we found in our evidence session on that that in its history it had never been independently evaluated, its performance had never been assessed. I was wondering why that was the case. And just briefly, when you listed the various organisations that are involved in the Management Board, and it's fantastic to have teachers, unions and parents in particular represented, it does leave the question, why is there no direct learner representation?
That's a pretty fair comment. So we'll address that.
Thank you.
Now, on the question of independent evaluation, the government invited the OECD, who have a global credibility and reputation for examining education systems, and they came in and they looked at Curriculum for Excellence, and that was a really timely intervention, because what the OECD did was essentially say, I think it's a report of two halves. One half said, you've undertaken bold, world-leading curriculum reform and you've done it well, but you've got to make sure that it now is embedded effectively and it succeeds in fulfilling the potential of all learners in Scotland. And that's the That's why we formulated the National Improvement Framework. It's what guides, you know, the fulfilment of the expectations of the OECD review are what are guiding my priorities as Education Secretary.
Interesting, but it's not an answer to the question that I asked about the Curriculum for Excellence Management Board, its structure, its performance being independently assessed. That was not the purpose of the OECD report. It touched on that, but that was not what it was looking at.
Well, but the OECD review actually looked at the Curriculum for Excellence Management Board and said that I'm pretty sure I would be able to find a... Well, I don't know if I will find a quote here, but there's a quote from the... Oh, wait a minute. Okay. Here it is. This is my letter. The OECD in its 2015 review recognised this had been the right approach, noting that the CFE Management Board has been well fitted to the task of implementing CFE as a Scotland-wide curriculum programme. That task required consensus and managing processes so that implementation, including that of assessment and qualifications, would happen as smoothly as possible. Page 104 of the OECD report. So the Management Board has had that independent assessment as part of that process, and there was a whole chapter in the OECD report about governance and decision making. So I think that's all been subject to evaluation, but I come back to the point I made to Mr. Johnson that I'm looking at whether we've, you know, in terms of what the OECD report throws up to us as the challenges that lie ahead, as to what the right governance arrangements are for handling that.
John.
Yep, thank you very much. Can I say, first of all, that I am a bit disappointed that the Cabinet Secretary's response to what I thought was a very measured report by the committee, and in fact, I would commend the convener on doing so well to bring forward what was a unanimous view of this committee and was a reflection of our concerns, and to highlight why I think I'm disappointed. The quote where it says, the chair of the CFE Management Board, Fiona Robertson, made this very clear to you at the evidence session 18th of January, and there are no grounds for members of the committee to be unclear on this point. Can I say to you, in a classroom, if you as a teacher said to a child, look, I've made this clear to you, there are no grounds for you not understanding, you would quite rightly be hunted. I mean, it just seems to me that if this committee unanimously are saying there are concerns, I think we would expect the Cabinet Secretary to reflect on that. And I don't think people are saying they're not in favour of Curriculum for Excellence. I think people are saying we're concerned about the way it's being implemented. And I wonder, I hear what you say about there are disagreements. I wonder what you think are the motivations of teachers who took the time to contact this committee to highlight their concerns. It can't possibly be that they've all lost the argument and therefore in some kind of curmudgeonly way feel obliged to pursue that argument through the committee. What do you think are the motivations of the overwhelming number of people who contacted us with their serious professional concerns?
Well, what I said to Tavish Scott is that I want to have an empowered profession that contributes to a debate about education, but what we need to do is to take a considered approach about all of these issues to make sure that we are taking steps to ensure the effective delivery of Curriculum for Excellence.
But do you recognise that there is an issue that was felt by the whole of the committee, that the evidence we got was telling us something that it isn't... Now, I'm assuming you would want to distance yourself from the views of, I think it's SQA, but basically what they were saying was, well, you know what some of these people are like, they don't like change, they prefer things to be done the way they were before. And as I pointed out at the time, I was involved in teaching at the point where there was a transformation around one and dunning and standard grades. And, of course, there were people who didn't want to change. But the vast majority of people then, as now, recognise the change. And when they're raising its concerns, it's because there are problems in them professionally delivering on that. Do you accept that this characterisation of the concerns of people who have highlighted these matters to us as being the usual suspects who would do that anyway is simply unfair? And if you accept that that's unfair, how do you respond in a serious way to these genuine concerns that people are highlighting, as opposed to, frankly, a rather arithmetical view which says, well, they don't really represent anybody, it's only 1%.
Well, in my letter, I say to the committee, whilst I welcome views from anyone involved in Scotland's education system and will always pay close attention to constructive criticism, I believe the points advanced by the committee on the performance of the SQA and Education Scotland in particular are not based on an assessment of a sufficiently broad evidence base. And my point there is that there is other evidence that the committee had at its disposal, which emerges from the dialogue that both of those organisations have, is conducted independently with other individuals and bodies, which would counterbalance some of that evidence that has emerged in the dialogue with the committee. Let me finish. I listen carefully to the teaching profession, the length and breadth of the country. I listen to the profession almost on a daily basis about issues. I get communicated with on a daily basis. I replied, I had an email last night from a head teacher raising issues with me, which I replied to personally in my email account last night to explore some of the issues that they were concerned about. So I take those points very seriously. But what I was inviting the committee to do was to reflect on a broader evidence base than what the committee heard and dwelt on in forming its report.
Happy to do that, but I think a mindset of those who say that people express concerns have simply lost the argument or are curmudgeons.
I'm not
saying that you do.
I've just set out I've just read out my view on the record about how I think we should consider criticism from individuals and to address it.
I just urge you not to explain away, which frankly, counting up the number of teachers who sent in comments as against the whole of the teaching profession, does that. You quite rightly accepted the evidence of Enable and NUSUWT earlier in relation to additional support needs, and I think, frankly, you should do that in this regard as well.
For completeness, convener, I'm going to go on to read more of my letter, because I highlighted the fact that SPICE, what I was talking about was the survey which the committee undertook, and SPICE said the description by the survey by SPICE as not based on a random sample, so may not be representative of the general population.
And I'm saying to you, if you get that amount of response and evidence, don't explain it away, try to understand it. But if I can maybe move on to a couple of other points. You talked about how basically the sign up across, and we've had some conversations on this in the past in this committee, sign up to curriculum for excellence, which I think is true. There are concerns about the way it's implemented. Can you explain to me who decided that it would be a good idea not to have an external exam in S4 for National 4? Because if I had known that at the point when I was signing up for Curriculum for Excellence, I would not have supported it. We never got any clarity from Education Scotland to the SQA about whose responsibility this was, and indeed when we pressed them, we said, well, this is a conversation that Scotland has to have. Who decided it, and will you look again at the consequences of that decision around motivation for some young people in fourth year, particularly given that their qualification not only is not externally assessed, but is assessed internally on a pass-fail basis?
Well, ministers decided there would be no external examination in NAT 4. And in my view, there are some significant, not just my view, the Assessment National Qualifications Group under my chairmanship have looked at the issues around National 4 because there is, I think, a question of the value and the esteem that is placed in National 4, which is not what it should be, and that is therefore not fair to the learners that are acquiring National 4. Now, to just take John Lambert's point, whether the answer to that is an external examination is a point on which there is divided opinion.
It's because of, you'll remember, certification for all and significance of that. That was a massive step forward in terms of valuing and respecting young people. You say ministers made that decision rather than the Curriculum for Excellence Management Board?
It was based on advice from the qualifications group.
Right. I'm not quite sure. I'll maybe explore with you separately on that question. The last issue I wanted really to raise with you in relation to another recommendation made by the Committee on Promise, that's the last one, is on the question of SDS ensuring its programmes are accessible and attractive to all young people. And this question about equal access, disproportionate apprenticeships going to young men rather than to young women, concerns about accessibility for people with disabilities and so on. Your response says equality impact assessments are conducted in all of the SDS programmes. Equality impact assessments are also undertaken in their web services to ensure they meet the needs of each user. Would you accept that individual programmes could be individually assessed as being of equal access, but if you don't look across the board at programmes in terms of their impact, you may miss the fact that, in fact, disproportionately few women, people with disabilities, access these programmes?
That is a fair comment, and I think the whole issue of ensuring that there are opportunities available for young people to address their needs and their capabilities, particularly given the growing significance of modern apprenticeships and the role that they perform within the opportunities that are available for young people, I think that's an issue that we need to take greater account of.
Okay, thank you
very much. Just before we finish off, Cabinet Secretary, two things, I suppose. One is that in relation to your letter, the reason why we put so much store by what the teachers had said is that the meeting, for example, that Ross Greer and I had with teachers in person tallied almost exactly with the survey results and, you know, with anonymous responses. So it did seem to say that those numbers said something. It wasn't, if it just been the anonymous responses, then I think it would have been, we'd have had a different look at it, but it tied in almost exactly with us, and it was mainly all around the SQA. So, I mean, I think the criticism that the SQA got in the report was justified. I would say, however, that I don't agree with Liz Smith's position that it seems that CFE is failing. We did talk about it not reaching a level of maturity we hope to have at this stage, but I don't know what your view is, but I'd have thought that the results yesterday on... Yes, please.
The delivery of the curriculum for excellence was failing. I didn't say the curriculum for excellence was.
Right, OK. So there's still, I mean, I think there's some unanimity that we have some work to do there, but obviously the outcomes that were shown yesterday, for example, must mean that the curriculum for excellence is working in some way. But
can I ask a very brief point on that question? I think the phrase that the Greener uses, we haven't quite reached that level of maturity yet. Do you think there should be a revisiting of the budgeting round delivery for the curriculum for excellence, because the budgets have been cut on the basis that it has reached a level of maturity? And I wonder if that's something you would also look at.
I think the guidance I'm taking on this is the assessment by the OECD. And the OECD did not say to us, you've nothing to do here. The OECD were very clear with us about the challenges that remain around the fulfilment of curriculum for excellence and the maximisation of its potential. So I'm very focused. That's what the National Improvement Framework is all about. It's about learning from the OECD report, putting that into practice. And one of the great things about where we are just now is the National Improvement Framework, in my view, has got real grip in the education system. I'm seeing it being applied in schools the length and breadth of the country, with head teachers undertaking their planning with their school and parental community based on what they can achieve by following the methodology of the National Improvement Framework. In a relatively short, I'm taking a lot of heart from that, because in a relatively short space and time, as a planning tool, that has got the education system focused on what we need it to be focused on, which is on improving performance. And I think there are many aspects of our current educational performance that are really strong. The data that you talked about yesterday, convener, is very encouraging data about the improvements in positive destinations that are taking place, the level of qualifications that have been achieved, the narrowing of the attainment gap that is taking place over the achievement of qualifications. All of these are very encouraging trends within Scottish education. But they neither support a narrative that says everything is a disaster, nor do they support a narrative which says everything in the garden is rosy. which is why I'm focused on an improvement agenda.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. And that takes us to the end of the public session. Thank you.